Welcome, everyone, to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Erie. My name is Kelly Armour, and I'm one of the co-coordinators of the service. And yes, thank you, Clyde. Shout out to Al Richardson, who truly did the heavy lifting of pulling this service together. I want to remind everybody that this service is getting recorded, and we post them all on YouTube so people can check them out later. So if you don't want your face on the video, you can simply turn off your video and you won't be seen. So if you are able, you can get a bell and a candle or a chalice. And as we have done since the beginning of the pandemic, we have this wonderful moment of joyous cacophony, where instead of ringing the church bell, we all ring our respective bells. So with the sound of bells, we welcome stranger and friend to a time of mindfulness. Unmute yourself and ring your bell. And for the welcoming song, Howard will lead it. Howard Crack.
Whoever you are, we welcome you. Wherever you come from, we welcome you. Whomever you love, we welcome you. Whoever you are, we welcome you. Wherever you come from, we welcome you. Whomever you love, we welcome you. Whomever you love, we welcome you.
Thank you, Howard. Opening words today, we gather in worship to find meaning and life more and live more deeply. Worship creates connections within, among, and beyond us, calling us to our better selves, calling us to live with wisdom and compassion. Now I have the prelude. It's chalice lighting time. And this is the message I have with our chalice lighting. In this free church, we come together without creed, focusing instead on the core values of justice, equity, and compassion. Janet will now read Janet, go ahead.
We are Unitarian Universalists, a people of open minds, loving hearts, and welcoming hands. We care for the earth and each other. And our bond of union together, we unite ourselves together for the study and practice of morality and religion as interpreted by the growing thought and noblest lives of humanity, believing that we may thereby prove helpful one to another and promote the cause of truth, righteousness, and love in the world.
So we have a wonderful reading that Al chose that is by the Reverend Eric Walker Wickstrom. And it comes from a work that he has called Spirit in Practice. After many years in a congregation, she'd had enough. Knowing the people as well as she did, she knew that what they said on Sunday and what they did on Monday did not always equate. More often than not, Sunday was the one day of the week on which you could tell that people believed what they said they did. The rest of the week, she could see little difference between the other members of the congregation and the hypocrites they denounced.
And the words of the hymns no longer spoke to her. They talked of things she had long ago given up believing, or were words that had no real meaning in her life. And the sermons weren't much better. Entertaining, perhaps, sometimes giving her something to think about, but a good book or independent film could do the same. And besides, she'd had to go when she was a kid and when her kids were young. But now?
No, she'd had enough. And so she began walking in the woods on Sunday mornings. Alone with her thoughts and the rustling leaves, she felt a freedom she had not known in a long time. She got more from the sunshine than from a year of sermons, and the birds surpassed any anthem she'd heard. This was good. This was right. The woods were her sanctuary. The wind was all the preaching she needed.
This continued for some time until one day she realized that the birds sang together and the trees swayed as one, but she was by herself. No squirrel cared that she had a new grandchild. No rhododendron could help her wrestle with her mother's Alzheimer's. The flora and fauna did not face what she faced as a human, and so could not offer their understanding, nor could she really offer herself to any of them.
So she returned to her congregation, and she saw herself in the people who were trying to live what they believed. and she heard her life in the hymns and the readings and the sermons, or at least some of the time. And she never gave up on her walks in the woods, but she realized she needed both. And Clyde, if you can bring up the next slide.
I have a short and timeless biblical teaching from the book of Philippians. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility, count others more significant than yourself. Let each of you look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Unquote. This is our offertory message each Sunday. Actually, our congregation is on a fiscal year basis, which expires on June 30th in a few days. So if you're behind in your pledge, please catch up. And if you're ahead, thank you very much. To introduce our guest speakers. The younger of the two guest speakers, Robert Tate, grew up in Erie. He's employed by Pennsylvania Career Link, where he works with youth from the area. His story is that of service. He's a people person, happiest when talking with people and learning about who they are and where they want to be. Robert wants to see this in our youth. He says, quote, I feel that there's so much untapped potential in them. It's up to us to help uncover this and help to guide them, unquote. The other guest speaker, Court Gould, is a 3-year Erieite and consultant. His quest is the urgent new business as usual, sustainable development. His compass points are renewable, repeatable, restorative, and just. According to Court, quote, Erie's only path to prosperity is empowering our remarkable diversity in pursuit of progress that is accountable to social, environmental, and economic values concurrently. After Robert and Court conclude their dialogue, they'll welcome your questions. Just raise your hand to be recognized and unmute your audio. Please keep the questions brief, and afterwards, be sure to mute yourself again. Kurt, you're on.
Thank you, Al, and everybody. Robert, I'll enjoy this conversation with you so much as I do every time we get together. It's lonely, very learning and selfish moments for me, my friend. It's really been something as we had our conversations in preparation for now, talking about what acceptance means to us, its literal nature and its figuratives as well. And we've unpacked a lot of depth about the word, both the positive and some of the otherwise, I think. Maybe some of those treads to look at, acceptance can be seen as also tolerance or coming to terms with futility or otherwise things that we can't change. In that use of the word, maybe there's no real deep buy-in, but rather a resignation. Another might be having paid one's dues or a rite of initiation to have earned membership, that is, being accepted into a club or into some social order. So we may be tempted on the negative to be or even do things that are not our trueness in order to be accepted. Another might be in receiving something without really an implied emotional response, to accept a package at your door or to accept platitudes for something you've done or even criticism. But in our conversations, Robert, we got into the deeper, more than the definition, more into the that which colors our perspectives of what we accept and what we don't accept. And by that, I mean our background, our culture, our true lived experiences that shape our judgment, our values when it comes to accepting or repelling or disagreeing. Are we deep thinkers or are we just blind followers? Are we just carelessly paying homage to what we've been taught to believe, or are we following righteousness? And before we go into our special topic on that, what would you like to share on that, Robert, on the definition?
Yeah, acceptance is a very unique topic. I mean, you spoke on a few things, you know, something that you've learned from other individuals, you know, growing up, learning acceptance, accepting oneself, accepting your culture, your background, you know, accepting, you know, where you live, you know, accepting yourself. I think people, you know, I think especially younger people, you know, they struggle with who they are today, and they struggle with where they want to go in life. And I think a lot of young people, they're kind of molded by, you know, their surroundings, family, you know, where they go to school, people that they hang around with. So I think Acceptance is a very personal topic. And I think that's something that you kind of have to learn yourself, you know, learning how to love yourself, but learning how to love others. And I think love is a very important word when we talk about acceptance, you know, not accepting someone for who they are, but loving them for who they are. And I think those are two very different words when we actually dissect the meaning of them, the true meaning of each of those.
Yeah, you mentioned your special heart passion of working with youth, Robert, which I respect so much. Maybe say a word about the impacts of social media on youth and the acceptance that young people feel.
Yeah, the young people are so, you know, involved in social media today, and that can be a good or a bad thing. I think, you know, parents are more aware of the impact of social media, of how they accept themselves, how they view themselves from other people's opinions and from what they see on social media. And yeah, social media, there's so much influence with that. And I think that young adults today, you know, they're always on their Twitters and their Facebooks and their Instagrams and different things like that. But social media is such a profound way to connect with our youth today. And I think, you know, that yes, there's negatives with it, but I think there's so much good that we can do with it if we learn how to connect with them. Because I think connecting with the youth today is the most profound thing. If it again, it's not, you know, I can't remember the exact statement, but it's not how much you know, but it's how much you care about them. And if we really show them that we care about them and we care about their futures and we care about the things that they care about, I think that they're more willing to listen to us and they're more willing to be susceptible to being taught by us. I think that's very important to just get on their level. And we have to earn their trust. You know, and I think that's one of the biggest issues is earning their trust, because a lot of youth don't think that we truly understand them. But I think if we, as adults, we learn to understand who they are, I think that'll be more impactful for us getting them on the right path.
Yeah, I hear in that the old saying of meeting someone where they are or walking in their shoes. And that's a good segue to what we've talked about in exploring acceptance, the meanings, and where we come around to perhaps a better title for our talk is Beyond Acceptance to True Buy-In, Understanding, Embracing, and Loving. And with that, the topic is COVID. COVID has had such a crystallizing, concentrating, satirizing effect on so many issues. And on this topic of acceptance, I, a white guy coming from a well-to-do background with extreme affordance of education and privilege, and frankly, an expectation of entitlement for everything that I ever wanted or needed now, without delay, an excuse. When the vaccines became available, it was my expectation, my entitlement, that I would have that as fast as possible. No, I didn't want to step in line of our frontline workers and those with health impediments that needed it first. But there was no question for me, from the truisms of science and my background, that the vaccine was the right thing, the expedient, the necessary thing for me to do. And indeed, I got myself and my whole family vaccinated as quickly as possible. How about you, Robert?
So me personally, no, I did not get the vaccine. And there's a bunch of different reasons, but I will speak from my community, from our history. So, you know, Black, brown, colored, you know, that community, we're not as eager or as quick to get the vaccine as others. And it's just because we tend to, I don't want to use the word fear, but we're not as adamant to believe everything that we hear, you know, from TV, from government, that we should just go and get something, especially in mass, the way that other communities have gotten it, you know, and this is kind of a trust issue. And just one example, I go back to the Tuskegee experiment, you know, and for those of you who don't know about that, that is a very horrible chapter in our history, but that's just one of the examples of why the colored community, the Black community, the Brown community does not go in and just take anything that that is suggested to us from our government. And then you also have, you know, access. You know, many of us don't have the access to the vaccine that other individuals have, you know, and not to segue into voting, but how many lines were there? How long did people have to wait for to vote? So the same thing with the vaccine. How many people had access to vaccines? How many vaccines were available in the lower, you know, communities where there were, you know, individuals who weren't necessarily middle class, for example? Because those who did have the ability to get access to these vaccines, a lot of those individuals also had the ability to relocate to certain areas where there weren't as many people. You know, maybe they had extra, you know, another house that they can go to get away from the larger population where there were so many people getting sick. And I've been watching the news, and I've been, you know, doing a little bit of research, and this has affected our community at a higher rate than other individuals, other communities. So it goes to question, you know, why, you know, what are we doing wrong? What aren't we getting access to? Why are we dying so easily? You know, and unfortunately, you know, I think this is just going to be an ongoing topic when we talk about, you know, health or the healthcare industry in the Black, Brown, and colored communities.
Yeah, so not only do I accept what you're saying, I understand, and I love you for it. It's a thoughtful position that the Black community has well reasoned and historical precedent to be skeptical of the vaccine. We have exploited our Black friends historically just terribly, and it's present and with us, and it continues around the globe today. What I have a hard time accepting, and I've got to work on it, are those who just reject the vaccine out of blind following a dogma that is spewed out in social media for political or other reasons, drinking the Kool-Aid, so to speak. But Robert, what do you say to someone who says, man, you're being selfish. We've got to get to herd immunity. And those who are not getting vaccinated are using their position, they're weaponizing it to harm us all.
Well, what I would say is for those individuals, I think it's important to do research, not just believe everything that someone in a powerful position tells you to do, because people, they tend to listen to someone who is in a powerful, influential position, and people tend to just, you know, see what they believe. The first thing they see, that's what they believe in. And I think the more we educate ourselves on these topics, I think the more we learn to be seekers of truth and not just accept what's put in front of us, I think people will be more independent. I think people will grow personally to understand that it's up to you as a person to formulate your own opinion, not let other people and external sources influence you or put an opinion in you that's not your own. And I think people are very intelligent, you know, that's why, you know, we're not accelerating in the, you know, vaccine as much as we want to. But I think we have to be our own leaders and not be followers. I think there's too many people who are just easily influenced and you know, they'll follow the first thing that sounds like what they believe instead of actually seeking and looking for truth on their own.
Yes. Well, to our friends of the UU, I hope you appreciate that this wasn't intended to be a debate about vaccine or no vaccine, but rather an illustration of the many threads in picking apart acceptance, with at least Robert and I arriving at the what we think is the truism of seeking truth, of not being a blind follower of whatever the case may be, but educating oneself, and where appropriate, going beyond acceptance to walking in that other person's shoes to truly understand, appreciate, and love and respect. And with that, Robert, unless you have anything else, we are happy, Al or Kelly, to have you moderate any questions that might come our way. Thank you, Robert.
Thank you.
Looks like Art's got his hand raised. Why don't you unmute Art and ask your question?
First of all, thank you for the conversation. As advocates for acceptance and diversity, what steps or actions would you suggest folks take if they want to move further down the road to greater acceptance and diversity? Thank you.
Robert, you are the wise man here. I defer to you.
I would say that the first things we should do is learn our history. You know, learn why we are where we are now. I think people, you know, they have their own understanding of history, but I think if we actually look at the reasons for where we are now and understand that, I think it's important to understand what changes happened or what events happened that led us to where we are now today. And then I would say, you know, get to know other cultures, get to know other people. If you don't know those individuals, learn about them, learn about their history, learn about, you know, their beliefs, learn about their culture. And, you know, on a personal level. I would say just continue to surround yourself with different people, you know, because I think the more, you know, the less we know about someone, the more we have our own opinion about these individuals. And I think that's been something that has happened for so long in our history. You know, we have our own preconceived opinions about people, different cultures, races, but unless we actually, you know, put our hand out and seek, you know, pursue learning about other people, I think we're just going to continue to have our own opinions about them instead of actually knowing them and forming our own opinion from actually having a personal relationship with these individuals.
Yeah, I like that, Robert. Maybe I'd add Art. I'd go to one of my favorite songs, Michael Jackson, Man in the Mirror. Start with a change of yourself. So often a problem someone has with somebody else is really a problem with themselves. Maybe it harkens to an insecurity. If you got a problem with somebody else, start working on yourself first, I think.
I would like to add a thought that history and reality and science are all facts. And they are the reality that civilization and we all have to live with. And So understanding what this reality consists of is our primary basis for the progress that humankind have made through the centuries. And I am concerned that there is a clear tendency to reject or limit what the hard reality of these facts are that we all have to live with. So I'm a simple-minded physical chemist. This is a basis on which I operate, with the belief that history is actually facts. So that's how we can combine that with acceptance is a good question for you all. The ball's in your court.
Well, being that my name is Court, I'll take that.
That's funny.
So we have to acknowledge that there is privilege in access to information and to education. And unfairness does not equip us all with the same facts, for example, where we get our information, what's been availed to us. So there's a huge conversation in America today about equipping our schools with curriculum that speaks the truth about history, about the facts. And in fact, in my privileged best you can buy education, we did not learn about subjugation of the natives that occupied North America, let alone the Underground Railroad and the tragedies of slavery. Those were wiped white clean from our curriculum. And can you believe today that we are debating this in our school districts around the country? So I understand what you're saying, Mr. McKnight, but we have to acknowledge that the information we carry is not necessarily equitably derived. How's that, Robert?
Couldn't have said it any better.
Linda Burfield, I know you have a question.
Okay, this is a question mostly directed at Robert. Robert, I, from adolescence on, grew up in the east side of Erie off of Buffalo Road. Graduated from East High School in 1972. I had zero, had no, very little money, very little opportunity, didn't go to college, yada, yada, yada. So, and I had very, very, very many Black friends, and I still have them, dear friends. My question to you is, I know it is difficult to get the vaccine out to the lower income communities that has been represented. You've illustrated that as being an issue. However, you have had access to it, and yet you haven't gotten it. So that sounds a bit hypocritical to me. This is coming from me, Linda Burfield, not the rest of the UU congregation, but I am throwing this out at you. So I don't want to hear about what Blacks don't have access to coming from someone who has had access to it. That in other words, that just kind of blew the whole thing out of the water for me. So I'm just saying that because I'm from the east side of Erie and I grew up with nothing. With that, I'll shut up.
So yeah, I definitely understand your point. And I'm not saying that all Blacks don't have access to it. I'm just saying there's a large proportion in America who don't have access to it. So yes, for those who do have access to it, yes, I've illustrated that there is, and again, I don't want to use the word, fear, but many of us are skeptical of getting this vaccine because we don't trust that it is actually going to help us, and I have personally, and I'm just speaking to me personally, I've heard of cases where people have gotten the vaccine and have gotten sick still. And I have heard cases where people have gotten the vaccine and have still died or infected other people. So me personally, I'm not getting the vaccine yet. I'm not saying I'm not getting it. I'm just saying I feel that it came out too fast. I feel that I don't have enough proof that it is helping people in my community. And that's the reason that I decided I haven't not to get it yet. Okay, so I'm not saying I'm not getting it. I'm just saying I feel that I personally don't have enough evidence to believe that it's going to help me going forward.
And as we discussed, this is not intended to be a debate about vaccine versus non-vaccine, but rather exploring deeply within ourselves our ability to walk in someone else's shoes and to not only accept, but embrace their perspectives and understand a bit more where they're coming from. Any other thoughts or questions for us? And Art or Al, respect, you can cut us off at any time in step with your tight agenda today.
Yeah, I think we might have time for one more question.
Kelly, I'm a host and somehow I can't raise my hand. May I?
I think it's because you're a host. I think that's the issue. Dixie.
My hand up too.
Okay, go ahead with the other one.
Did you see my hand? Linda Graff. I just want to make a quick comment. I've been doing a lot of workshops and stuff through UU since I joined last November. And up until probably a couple months ago, literally, I'm in my 60s. I thought everyone thought the way I did. I mean, the world was like the way I saw it. And, you know, my way is the logical way. And why doesn't everyone think the way I do? Now in my 60s, I'm finally coming to realize and accept that no one thinks the way I do. And if I believe that, that's a much better way to believe than thinking that people see the world the way I do. Thanks.
And thank you, Linda. I suspect that's a liberating, anxiety reducing life mindset to take on. So I wish on all of us, we arrive at your level of sophistication. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I add just a little thing? Do we have time?
Sure.
I just wanted to share with Court and Robert that quite a number of years ago, we had a sign out in front of the driveway that said, "Religious diversity tolerated here." And back then, the word tolerate and tolerance was very popular. It was like, we can tolerate this, you know, and it was like a big deal. And we thought this was a grand statement. And then over the years, we realized that that wasn't enough. And a couple years ago, maybe four or five now, we talked about changing the sign. And I had been teaching the Seven Habits and of Highly Effective People, and they talked about going from tolerance to celebrate. So tolerance, acceptance, and celebrate the diversity. So we've come a long way, but it's still a challenge to have it be from Sunday to Sunday in our own lives, but that's what we're going for, celebrating our diversity. Thank you.
Wow, wonderful. Well, this was really great. I mean, acceptance is a very, very deep issue. And there's, it is, and it really gets cuts, I think, to the core of who we are and what we believe in and some of our deepest feelings and emotions. And I want to thank both of you, Court and Robert, for such a beautiful presentation that really gave wonderful examples and thought about it from all these different aspects. That's a lot to try to fit into a short period of time. And I really speak on behalf of the congregation that you did it elegantly and thoughtfully. And I think we've given us all a lot of food for thought.
Well, thank you, as you always do, for creating a safe place for people to share without attack or criticism or judgment. And Robert, thank you. And I look forward to our ongoing conversation and growth as friends.
Thank you. Thank you all for having us.
All right. So I am going to let Janet take it from here with joys and concerns.
It is time now for joys and concerns. And if you would like to use the chat box to share a few adjectives about how you're feeling, it's important not to respond publicly to anyone else's entry. We're just going to bear witness to each other's states of mind. And if there is something that we need to share with Reverend Christina, we will do that. So please feel free to use the chat box now. This morning, during Joys and Concerns, people expressed gratitude for the message this morning. Many people were complimentary and appreciated the chance to look at something.
So, I'm sorry, Janet, your audio isn't coming through. Can you put yourself maybe more center to the screen? I think it'll be a little louder. Sorry about that.
Is that better? Is that any better? Oh, okay, I see she's great. Starting over. People expressed gratitude this morning for the message and were very appreciative of our two speakers. And people said that they realize that their view of the world is not the only view and that there are probably many right ways to look at things. Someone expressed joy at having their family enjoy a professional sports game together. People are appreciative of the out of doors. And
we're again very grateful for our speakers today. And also there was news that our friend and member Jim Wise had surgery this week. I think that's all.
Thank you, Janet. And Al, you'll do the closing words in extinguishing the chalice.
Yeah. I have the closing words, which are actually on the screen now. Spirit of abundance, may we be with one another in solidarity and struggle. May the presence of one another across oceans of separation allow hope and optimism to rise. Now it's time to extinguish your chalices, if you have any. I don't know where my camera is. At any rate, I stopped the video. Okay, here we go with extinguishing the chalice. The flame is extinguished, but not our hope for the future. Our courage in the face of crisis, or the love we share in all the world. It's time now for the postlude.